Good morning and welcome to every single one of you that are tuned into Emmanuel Church London. It is so good to be with you again. My name is Ben.
My name is Rebecca.
And as always, just want to say a massive welcome to every one of you. If it is your first time, particularly a special welcome to you. Just to say, we'd love to connect with you, not just on Sundays, but all through the week. So please do make sure that you follow us on all our different socials, Instagram, Facebook, but also to sign up to our YouTube channel. Turn on notifications just so you get those reminders through the weeks when we're doing devotionals, encouragements coming from the Word of God, and keeping in touch with all the different content that's coming out and coming your way.
So last week, Stu Gibbs kicked us off in our new series. We're looking at Psalm 121. Mm-hmm. And today we are hearing from Stu Baker, who will be reading from, or preaching from, sorry, verses 3 and 4.
That's right. But before we go there, we want to just start again in a place of sung worship. And I know that it is continuing to be a challenge for so many of us. And it's just important for us to remember, before we open our mouth to sing, that it's okay for you, even in the comfort of your own home, to stand or to kneel, to lift your voice. I know it can be a bit awkward. Rebecca's heard me sing before, and it can be a little bit awkward, but we really want to encourage you with that. Throughout the course of history, men and women, young and old, have gathered together in small gatherings and in big gatherings to worship God. And so we are in a season where we just need to embrace the small sometimes. So I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to hand over to the guys that are going to lead us in worship. And I would encourage you to lift your voice. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much that you are worthy to be praised. I thank you that you are the true living God. And I thank you that the reason that we are engaged together today is the common ground of you. It's the reality of you sending your son, Jesus Christ, who lived, who died, and who is risen from death to life, seated on the throne. And Lord, I thank you that the implications for that for us are huge. And it means that we have life eternal. It means that our sin is dealt with once and for all. It means that death is dealt with once and for all. And we want to come today with thankfulness in our hearts, and we want to lift our voices to you. And so as we sing right now, Father God, would you receive the worship and praise that is due your name. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Amen.
It breaks the power. our Lord, you are worthy to be praised. You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised.
You are Alpha.
You are Alpha.
Father, thank you for your good name. Thank you, Father, just for that time of worship and that time that we've just spent glorifying your name, Father. And I just pray as we hear from the word of God this morning, settle our hearts, God, to have an ear that is willing to hear from you, God, that the what Stu brings to us this morning, God, would penetrate our hearts, God, beyond the surface, Father, deep in those places, God, where it needs to be heard. I pray, Father, help us to fix our eyes on you, God, to concentrate, Lord, and to engage, God, with the word this morning. In your name, amen.
Amen. So just before we hear from Stu, we're actually just going to hear again on the subject of New Day. So all throughout August, we're going to just take these moments where we hear from different people speaking on different subjects and praying into them. This week, we're actually going to be hearing from some of our young people that experienced New Day. So hopefully they'll be kind, because Rebecca and I were hosting it. But more than that, we want to hear some of the things that God's been doing in young people's lives. So we're going to hand over to the Emmanuel Youth, and we're going to hear a few stories from them.
And I've been doing New Day online with some of the youth, and the stuff they've been doing about New Day is really relevant to what we're learning about now, like racial inequality and all the things that have been happening over quarantine and over this year. They've really helped with mental health and what we're learning about today as young adults.
Hi, my name's Moom and I'm in year 6 going into year 7. This week has been my first time in youth and I have really enjoyed getting to know new people and being included in the fun games.
I'm walking through Greenwich, the back streets of Greenwich. We're looking for a baby on board sign for the scavenger hunt, at which you get, I think it's about 100 points for this one, and we're having loads of fun.
A scavenger hunt all around Greenwich, and we're going to make a sandcastle.
Is that
take a picture while making your sandcastle. It doesn't say you actually made a sandcastle.
And we just made a sandcastle as one of the...
We just finished the scavenger hunt, and our team won with 7,700 points.
This is Emmanuel Church in KFC on night 3, effectively night 2 of New Day for Emmanuel Church.
Great, well thank you so much guys. It's good to hear from the young people of Emmanuel about New Day. We just want to finish by praying just for this nation again. One of the reasons that Rebecca and I love doing New Day is because we care not just about the young people in our church or even just in our city. We genuinely are passionate about seeing a generation come up in the UK that know the true living God and are in relationship with him. And so we want to take this opportunity again. We've been praying a lot this week, but to pray again now as a church for the young people. It is difficult and challenging times ahead. And so let's just take this seriously as we pray for them. Father God, I do thank you that you are a God of every generation. There is not one generation that you overlook or forget. And I pray in the name of Jesus that you would use us in these days to be a blessing to the emerging generations. Lord, with so many challenges that they face and a world changing so rapidly, we're asking, Father, that you would draw close, that you would help us to point people to you, to who you are, to your great Son. We pray that many, many young people would come to know you and would be filled with the Holy Spirit. We pray for a generation that emerges in the UK to see things happen that are beyond our dreams. We just ask, Lord God, that you would win to yourself, Lord God, this emerging generation. And we ask it in the glorious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So we're going to hear from the Word of God. Stu Baker is going to continue our Psalm 121 series, and he's going to be preaching right now from verses 3 and 4. So let's hear from Stu.
Hello, Emmanuel. Hope you are all doing really well. This week we are in week 2 of our August summer series going through Psalm 121. We are taking 2 verses at a time. We're going for 4 weeks deep into the richness of Psalm 121. And today we are looking at verses 3 and 4. There are loads of ways that you could describe the season that we have all been walking through recently. You could describe it as a season of change, a season of worry, a season of isolation. If you're Zoom, then it's been a season of opportunity and probably lots of money. But perhaps one of the best ways to describe like the past 4 months or so that we've been going through is that it's been a season of limitations. Limitations. The virus has imposed new limitations on us, and it's also revealed existing limitations which we may not have been able to see so clearly before. We've experienced social limitations. We've had to stay in our homes. We've not been able to meet friends and family. For those of us who've been sick, we've experienced physical limitations, the limitations of on our bodies. For those of us who have lost jobs or have been on furlough, we might have experienced financial limitations. We're heading into holiday season now, and a lot of us might be experiencing travel limitations with travel bans and quarantines. And perhaps fundamentally at kind of the root of all of those is that we've felt less in control of, more limited in our control of our lives more generally, less control. We've had less control over our ambitions, our day-to-day life, our career trajectory, whatever it might be. This season has revealed a fragility in our control. It's revealed how the control that we feel can be taken away. It's revealed our limitations. And today we come to Psalm 121, and it takes us to the one who is limitless, who is limitless, the one who is always in control. In the verses we're going to be looking at today, it tells us about who God is. We're going to be looking at what this psalm says about who God is. And then we're going to try and unpack that and apply and look at if what it says about who God is and apply it to who God is for us. So look at who God is and unpack it and try and apply it to understand who God is for us. So let's read the first 4 verses of Psalm 121. It says this. If you've got your Bibles, grab them. It says this in Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. So what does this psalm tell us about who God is? What does it tell us about his nature? Last week, Stu Gibbs covered the first two verses. He kind of walked us through the first two verses where it says, he is the Lord. God is the Lord. He's the maker of heaven and earth. He is the covenant God of Israel. His name is Yahweh. He is the creator. He created all things. All things that exist find their source in him, find their origins in him. He is the one who made the mountains, and he is the one who was able to make the mountains melt like wax. He is the creator God. That's verse 2. And then we get into our verses for today, verses 3 and 4, and it says that God is a God who does not slumber or sleep. He is a God who does not slumber or sleep. In verse 4, it says, behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Bible is the word of God. Every word in this book is there to build us up. It's there to glorify God. It's there to reveal Jesus. It's there to tell God's story. And that's why as a church, we place so much importance on reading it, on teaching from it, on digging into it together. And the words that are translated into English as slumber and sleep in our Bibles, as we've just read, are translated from two different Hebrew words. They're very similar words. They mean similar things, but they're not quite the same, which is why they're translated as two different words, slumber and sleep. And I think those two words are included in this psalm because they help point us to very similar but different attributes of who God is. The words translated as slumber come from a root meaning to be drowsy. The implication is that slumber comes from being exhausted, from coming to the end of yourself, from lacking energy. When you slumber, you are tired and you are recharging your batteries. And the word translated as sleep comes from a root word meaning to be slack or inactive. The implication is that the word is more talking about the inactivity of sleep, the fact that when you sleep, you are still. And God neither slumbers nor sleeps. So what does that mean? What does that actually mean about who God is? Let's take slumber first. Do you ever feel tired? Maybe you feel tired right now. For a lot of us, one of the limitations that we will have experienced in this season is physical tiredness. For a lot of people, the last 4 months have just been a million miles an hour, constantly on the go, constant pressure, constant change. For some of us, work would have been the busiest it has ever been. We've had to radically change our businesses, change how we work, and change how we manage our teams, how we interact with our teams. There's been just constant change to get through. Some of us will be key workers in hospitals and schools and shops who have had to keep working all throughout the season under stressful conditions through the whole time. You've been on the front line. Maybe you just need a break. We get tired because we are limited human beings, right? It's normal to get tired. It's normal to need a break. We weren't made by God to keep going and going and going. He made us to be a people who lay down our tools and take regular rest. In 1959, a guy called Peter Tripp over in the States, who's a radio presenter, took on the challenge of presenting his radio show for 201 hours nonstop in a wake-a-thon. To raise money for a children's charity in New York. He was put in a glass box in Times Square, and he was monitored by doctors and scientists as he tried to stay awake for 201 hours in order to present his radio show. By day three, he was so badly affected by this lack of sleep that he was kind of shouting at passers-by, and he was starting to hallucinate. He thought spiders were coming out of his shoes because he couldn't cope with the lack of rest. It's not possible for a human being to survive without rest. But God doesn't slumber. He doesn't tire. He doesn't need a break. He doesn't need to recharge or refresh. He is constantly and forever at 100% of his perfect and all-powerful capacity. He is always powerful. His strength is perfect. He doesn't go to bed to switch off for the night. He doesn't need to. So God doesn't slumber. But he also says, Psalm 121 says he doesn't sleep. That means that he's never inactive, that he's never dormant, that he's never waiting around or wasting time. He never takes his eye off the ball. Often the conversation in church and in Christianity, maybe more generally, is about what we can be doing for God, that can be where our focus is, on our efforts for God, on serving God, on our ministry, on what we can do. And that's not bad in and of itself. It's not bad to think about those things. We're called to be the hands and feet of Jesus. We're called to tell people the gospel. We're called to serve the poor with actions as well as words. But often, I think we forget that God is the tireless worker. He is boundless, limitless in his activity. He is constantly working on behalf of those who love him. And that's you if you follow Jesus. It says in the Bible that the eyes of God are constantly searching the face of the earth to strengthen the hearts of those who love him. But sometimes our attitude can slip into thinking that God needs us to be working, that somehow if we weren't involved, God would have a massive problem on his hands. Fundamentally, God isn't looking for help from us. We need help from him. He is the tireless worker. He is the one who is always active. He is the one who is always on the move, limitless in his work and activity. So who does Psalm 121, who does it say that God is? In verse 2, it says that he is the creator of heaven and earth. In verse 3 and 4, it says that he neither slumbers nor sleeps. He's never tired. He does not need a rest. He's constantly and consistently full of power and strength. He's always moving, always active, never stopping, never dormant. That's who God is. That's who God is. So what does that mean for us? What does that mean for who God is for you and for me? How do I think about that in my own life? Well, it says in these verses, it says, he will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. So the first thing to pull out is that God who is tireless, completely powerful, always attentive, always working, that God is our keeper. That word keeper, it means God is our guardian. In the Old Testament, he was the keeper of Israel. He was the guardian of his people. He made a covenant with his people that he would be their God and they would be his people. And that's the relationship that the tireless, always active, completely powerful. That's the relationship that we have with the completely powerful God through Jesus as well. That's the echo of the relationship that we have with him as well. We are his new covenant people. Just like a legal guardian today would take responsibility for a child under their care, that's the relationship that we have with God as his people under the covenant that we have with Jesus. Through Jesus, we can call God our Father. He is our dad. Through Jesus, he makes a new covenant with us to take care of us, to bless us, to be with us. We are his people. And it says that God, our guardian, our keeper, won't let our feet be moved, won't let our foot be moved. He won't let us fall. He won't let us slip. And I don't know about you, but when I read that, I immediately have questions. Because I know that sometimes I slip. Sometimes I fall. I know that others around me fall and slip, whether that's because of our own sin or someone else's sin or just normal run-of-the-mill hard stuff and of life and tragedy. Even in this season, we know that there have been times for many people, even in our church, some people have been hit hard by this season. So what does it mean when God says that he doesn't let our foot slip? When you come to a verse like this in the Bible, the first thing you've got to do is take a step back. You've got to take a step back and look at the whole picture of Scripture. If your focus is just on one brushstroke, one verse, sometimes you need to step back and see how it forms part of the whole painting. We need to see how this verse forms part of the whole painting of Scripture. And when you look at the whole of Scripture, could this mean that nothing bad will ever happen to you if you follow Jesus? Definitely not. But when you look at the bigger story of Scripture and you look at what we've just seen about who God is, it does mean at least two things. First thing, it means that God's strength means that you will always have a future hope. God's strength means that you will always have a future hope. And second thing, it means that God's activity means he is always working on your behalf. He's always working on your behalf. So let's take that first one. God's strength means that you will always have a future hope. God is tireless. He doesn't slumber. His power is limitless. Nothing can thwart his plans or promises. That means that even when we fall in our walk with him, whether that's due to our own failure, the failure of others, or just circumstance, he's still able to carry us forward to our ultimate destination as long as we put our faith in him. Take, for example, the biblical story of King David, one of Israel's kings in the Old Testament. God promises King David that his royal line, his ancestors, would last forever, that one of his descendants would sit on the throne forever. But there's a time in David's life when he should have been leading his people, he should have been serving his country, defending it from its enemies, when David instead decides to shirk his responsibilities and stay at home. And he's on the roof of his palace and he sees a beautiful woman named Bathsheba. And Bathsheba is actually married to another man, one of David's most loyal soldiers, who at that very moment is at the front fighting for him, fighting for David's kingdom, for his country, where David should have been. And what happens is David takes Bathsheba, he kills her husband and he marries her himself. His foot slips, he falls into temptation and sin through laziness and a wandering eye. But David repents, he turns back to God, and God always keeps his promises. God is able to even use his evil intentions for good. God is strong enough to keep his promise to David despite David falling, because Jesus is one of David's ancestors. And Jesus is now seated on the throne of heaven forever and ever. David's royal line will stretch into eternity through Christ, just the way that God promised David. And even for Bathsheba, who was manipulated by a man in power, who lost her husband, even for her, it's her son, Solomon, that Jesus traces his human ancestry through. Her story is woven, her story of pain, her story of suffering, her story of all that David did to her, her story is woven into the grace, into the story of grace that redeems the whole world. God is strong enough to bring hope out of Bathsheba's pain. He's strong enough to redeem that messy, abusive, imperfect situation and out of it deliver the future hope of the entire world in Jesus. Sometimes when we fall or we are facing the really hard stuff of life, we can start to question whether God is able to deal with the situation that we're in. We can start to believe the lie that what we face is too big for God, that we can start to listen to the voice that would have us believe that it's just a hopeless situation, that tells us to give up, that tells us that God would never want you back anyway, that God can't do anything with you now, that he can't handle what you're facing. But Psalm 121 says that God is your keeper. He is your guardian. He doesn't slumber. He never gets tired. He is powerful. One thing me and my wife have found helpful when we're feeling overwhelmed by the stuff of life, just everyday stuff of life, is very simply at the end of the day, turning it over to God in prayer. As we're falling asleep, simply praying, Father, we're facing this. We're worried about this. we have to do this tomorrow. We give it to you before we go to bed. Will you carry this for us? Because he's up all night anyway, right? He's not sleeping. And he can carry it way better than we can. He has always and will always be mighty to save you when you turn to him. You may fall temporarily, you may slip sometimes, but when you put your faith in him, he will not let your foot slip from where he is ultimately taking you. His strength is sufficient for you. His power is enough. He will lead you home to himself. He will keep his promise to be your keeper, to be your guardian. He doesn't get tired. He never will. God's strength means that you will always have a future hope. God's strength means that you will always have a future hope. That second one. God's activity means that he's always working on your behalf. God's activity means that he's always working on your behalf. Sometimes it feels like God is just asleep on the job, right? That he's taking his hands off the steering wheel. But Psalm 121 says that God is always active. He's never dormant. He doesn't sleep. He never closes his eyes to what's going on in your life or my life. Our keeper neither slumber nor sleeps. And that is true in a number of different ways. There are just fundamental ways that God is constantly and consistently keeping, protecting, and serving us. He works through creation, the world around us, as the seasons change and the soil allows food to grow. He works through governments and human authorities that allow societies to peacefully exist. He works through people's moral consciences to restrain sinful human actions and their full impact on one another. But he's also active in the detail of our lives, the nitty-gritty stuff of everyday life. And even in the hardest moments of life, that is true. God is often, in my experience, graciously working in the details of those seasons. He's never inactive. He may not be doing what I was hoping. It may be hard, but he's always active. He's never, ever passive. He's never taken his eye off us. Take, for example, the story of Joseph from the Bible. You can look it up in Genesis. Joseph had 11 brothers who hated him. He was his father's favorite, and his father gave him a multicolored coat, which made his brothers hate him even more because he was arrogant and boastful, and he showed it off to them, and he made them feel small. And Joseph didn't really help the situation at all. And eventually, his older brothers got sick of him. They decided to attack him, to try and kill him. In the end, though, they only ended up throwing him down a pit and selling him into slavery. And Joseph ended up in Egypt as a slave. He was accused of a false crime by his master and ended up in jail. In jail, he got a reputation for his God-given gift of interpreting dreams. And so when the king got a dream, Joseph was summoned. And as a result of his interpretation of the king's dream, he was made the most powerful person in the whole country. Joseph, in that story, faced rejection from his family, physical abuse, imprisonment, abandonment. But in all of the hardship, God was present in the details. His brothers were convinced to show Joseph mercy. Joseph was placed in a prison with royal servants who were able to recommend him to the king. God gave Pharaoh, the king, dreams. He gave Joseph the interpretation of those dreams. Joseph experienced hardship, but God was in the detail. Always active, making sure his foot did not slip too far, redeeming what was meant for evil to turn out for good in the end. But I bet when Joseph was down in a pit, it didn't feel like God was active in the detail. When he was in prison, I bet there were moments where it didn't feel like God was in the detail. And sometimes when it doesn't feel like he's in the detail, when it's not obvious, you can believe the lie that God doesn't care. That he's closed his eyes, that he's having a nap, that you don't matter to him. But Psalm 121 tells us that's not true. And that's what's more, not just Psalm 121, what's more, the cross of Jesus tells us that's not true. Because at the cross, God made good on his promise in a fundamental and eternal way to be our keeper, to be our guardian. He shows how far he will go to not let our foot stumble, to not let our foot slip from his ultimate purpose of bringing us back to himself. At the cross, the limitless one, the one without limits, embraced our limitations. Jesus, the Son of God, laid down his strength. God himself became weak. He allowed himself to be abandoned and hurt and rejected so that he could take us to a place with God the Father where all those things would come to an end eventually. Jesus, the eternal Son of God, entered the sleep of death. He was motionless in a borrowed tomb so that we can have fullness of life for all eternity. If you trust in Jesus, God is your keeper, your guardian. He is committed to care for you. That commitment took him to the cross. And if it took him there, he's not going to sit back and leave you on your own now. He's going to be your keeper now because he was your keeper there. He was your guardian there. God never takes his eyes off his people. His heart burns for his people. He is jealous for you. He is jealous for you. He died for you. He's always active on your behalf. If you have come out of this season feeling the limitations of a physical tiredness, feeling powerless, feeling anxious, feeling worried about money, worried about your health, then Psalm 121 says, remember, he will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. If you've come out of this season feeling like things are out of your control, out of control, and God isn't interested in you, remember, behold, the one who keeps you will neither slumber nor sleep. I'm just going to pray. Father, thank you for what it says in this psalm. Thank you that you are the God who neither slumbers nor sleeps. And thank you that you have on the cross, Lord Jesus, you have made a way for us to come back home to God the Father. And Holy Spirit, I just pray right now for people who need to know the care of God. Holy Spirit, I pray come and fill people right now with your power, with your presence, Lord. Come and minister to those of us who need to know that our Lord is our keeper, and you neither slumber nor sleep. You don't get weak. You are not weak. You don't get tired. You are full of power and strength, and your eyes are on us. You are jealous for us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You are so good. Amen. Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail. Thou hast been, thou forever will be.
Great.
And great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
Courses.
Yeah, Father God, we do thank you for who you are. I thank you that you are perfect in every single way and that you never change. You're not more of one thing than the other at any given moment. And we just thank you for that, Lord. It gives us a hope. It gives us security. It helps us to know these things as we draw close to you. It gives us security and safety in you. And we love you for it, Lord. We love you for who you are. And I do pray that as we continue today, that we wouldn't move far from that knowledge. As Stu's spoken to us today, I pray that the word that he's brought to us would be in our hearts and in the forefront of our minds, and that we would just draw close to you today and in the coming days as a result. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, that's it for this week. But if you've heard anything that you would love to go deeper in, then please email us at prayer@emmanuelchurchlondon.org. We'd love to hear from you. And if you're just looking in, also hit up that email as well, because we want to connect with you. And don't forget, also, you can connect with us online. Instagram, follow us. Facebook, follow us. And on YouTube, make sure you subscribe. Hit the notification bell so that you are updated with everything that goes on in Emmanuel Church London. Well, have a great week.
Indeed. You do that bit so well, just to say. Have a great week, everybody. See you soon.